Good morning. Can I welcome everyone to the fifth meeting of the Education and Skills Committee in 2017? Can I please remind everyone present to turn their mobile phones and other devices onto silent for the duration of the meeting? We've received apologies from Fulton McGregor, MSP, and Clare Adamson, MSP, is attending as substitute. Apologies have also been received from Richard Lockhead, as he is attending another committee meeting this morning. Before we start the first agenda item, I'd like to put on record the committee's sincere thanks to Fiona Sinclair, who is our administrative assistant, has moved to a new role in the Parliament after over 10 years supporting this and other committees. We wish Fiona well in her new role, and can I also welcome Jane Davidson to the clerking team. The first item of business is a decision whether to take item 8 of this meeting in private. Are members content? Thank you. Given this is the first time Clare Adamson has attended the Education and Skills Committee, the second item of business is an opportunity for Clare to declare any relevant interests.
Thank you, Convener. As well as drawing attention to my declared register of interests, I particularly want to declare that I'm a board member of the Scottish Schools Education Research Centre, SSERC.
Thank you very much, Clare. Okay, that takes us on to the two pieces of subordinate legislation to consider today. For the benefit of people watching, hopefully that's not you, Minister, I should explain that each instrument has two agenda items. Firstly, where the committee will take evidence and have the opportunity to ask questions of the Minister and his officials. And secondly, a debate on a motion which seeks the committee's recommendation that the instrument is approved. We'll start with consideration of the Schools Consultation Scotland Act 2010, Modification Regulations 2017. And I welcome to the meeting Mark MacDonald, MSP, Minister for Childcare and Early Years, Jeff Maguire, Policy Manager, and Lorraine Stirling, Principal Legal Officer, Scottish Government. I understand the Minister wishes to make an opening statement.
Yes, Convener. Thank you for the opportunity this morning to address the committee in connection with a proposed further suspension of specific consultation requirements for local authorities under the Schools Consultation Scotland Act of 2010. As you know, we are committed to nearly doubling the current early learning and childcare entitlement to 1,140 hours per year by 2020. The expansion will require a substantial increase in workforce and infrastructure. The draft Scottish Budget for 2017-18 proposes allocating £61 million to support the first phase of this expansion. Additionally, the expansion will also require new and innovative models of delivering ELC, a rethinking and reconfiguring of provision at local level, which we are currently exploring through our blueprint consultation and delivery model trials. The Schools Consultation Act of 2010 requires education authorities to comply with a number of statutory requirements before they proceed to implement a new proposal in relation to an education authority managed school or early years centre. The process takes 6 to 9 months on average. Proposals to establish a new nursery school or nursery class in a school and to relocate existing nursery schools or nursery classes are classed as relevant proposals for the purposes of the 2010 Act. The Children and Young People Scotland Act 2014 introduced a requirement on education authorities to ensure that 600 hours of ELC per year is made available for eligible preschool children, which came into effect on 1st August 2014. In order for authorities to be able to comply with this requirement, the consultation requirements in the 2010 Act were suspended until 31st March 2017 regarding the establishment of all new nursery schools and classes. We've listened to the clear messages from local authorities and their representative bodies, ADES, COSLA and SLGP, that a further suspension of such consultation requirements is needed to enable the expansion to 1,140 hours by August 2020. Lobbying from local government has centred around the timescales required for such a major expansion of ELC under the 1,140 hours programme plan. Fully developed and robust local service delivery plans won't be completed until later this year, with construction under these plans therefore not able to commence until the first half of 2018 at earliest. It would only be from that point on that authorities could begin specific consultation requirements under the 2010 Act on what they propose to build and or relocate and where, thereby delaying the onset of construction by another 6 to 9 months. This could create a risk that sufficient new infrastructure will not be completed in time for 2020, given the numbers of new infrastructure projects required and the lead-in times required for construction. It's important to emphasise that all new ELC infrastructure projects will still be subject to national and local planning procedures and laws, which will ensure that there are still statutory requirements on local authorities to plan all new ELC infrastructure in a sensitive manner, which takes account of local circumstances and community views. This requirement is covered by the Town and County Planning Scotland Act 1997 and the Scottish Planning Policy, which underpins local development plans. Furthermore, local authorities are also subject to the requirement in Section 1.2b of the Education Scotland Act 1980 to consult parents of preschool children every 2 years about how they should provide for such children. The draft regulations in front of you have therefore been drafted to modify Schedule 1 of the 2010 Act to meet the proposal that education authorities should not be required to comply with the specific consultation requirements in the 2010 Act if they want to establish new nursery schools or new nursery classes in schools and or relocate existing nursery schools and nursery classes in schools as part of their expansion planning for 1140 hours. This exemption will not apply to establishment or relocation proposals relating to primary or secondary schools, nor to proposed nursery school or nursery class closures, which will of course still have to comply with 2010 Act consultation requirements in full. These regulations therefore propose modifying Schedule 1 of the 2010 Act from 31st March 2017, when the current order expires, and I therefore move that the draft modification regulations are approved by the Education and Skills Committee this morning ahead of formal parliamentary approval next month. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. Can I just clarify there that are there plans to reintroduce the duty to consult on the creation or relocation of nursery schools and classes at a later date?
Well, there is the option available to us once the suspension is no longer required to seek a further modification at a later date. We've not taken a firm decision in relation to that at present, but the option remains open to us. But as I've stated, there are a number of means by which consultation can take place in relation to early learning facilities under the various acts that I've listed in my opening statement.
And before I open it up to other members, just one last question. Why are these changes not time-limited?
The changes are not time limited because we've concluded that at the moment what we would want to do is keep an open mind in relation to what may be required further down the line so that we don't face a similar situation that we faced with the 31st March 2017 expiration of having to come back to committee and seek further suspension. So that is the reasoning behind our decision in relation to that.
Okay, thank you. Do you want?
Thanks very much, Minister. Just a number of points just for clarification. Why originally would the Scottish Government have put in a proposal to suspend to the 31st of March 2017 if they hadn't thought that it was achievable, that it wasn't necessary to go beyond that? Why at that point did you simply go for a suspension? Now basically you're getting rid of the provision altogether.
That was based on the policy approach at the time, which was around the 600-hour entitlement, and that obviously predated our decision to expand to 1,140 hours. So the current proposal, the policy that we're pursuing, was not the policy that we were pursuing at the time that we put forward those modifications
with
initially.
With respect, it might argue that you're pursuing a policy where you've not thought through the consequences. You've started within hours, and you've started with end time, and then you've worked your way backwards, and I think that may be a matter of some concern that you're now saying in order to fulfil that proposal we have to get rid of this other consultation process.
If I could just clarify in relation to that.
Can I ask if you considered the option of simply saying this form of consultation as identified in the 2010 Act doesn't enhance anything? You suggested that there are still other provisions there that protect the community, protect local interests. Why would you not then just simply get rid of that proposal to consult across the educational, across the board?
Because the proposal that we're taking forward in relation to early learning centres is very different from the approach that would be taken in relation to primary and secondary schools, because this is specifically informed by a policy approach being taken in relation to the expansion of hours at early learning centres, whereas in relation to schools, that's not a proposal we're taking forward. Also, in terms of the consultation opportunities that I highlighted, the two-yearly consultation with parents around early learning and childcare is of course specific to that early learning and childcare. But I just want to clarify in relation to the first point that you made where you said that we hadn't thought through what we were doing. In terms of the 600 hours, the proposal in relation to 31st March 2017 related specifically to our expansion to 600 hours, which has taken place. So all children in Scotland are now entitled to receive 600 hours, and the proposals that were put through in relation to that at local level have been enacted. What we're looking at here is in relation to our policy in relation to expansion to 1140 hours, which is a policy that we obviously introduced post the last election following our manifesto success at the election campaign. So we couldn't have in 2014 made provision for a policy that we had not put forward to the people until the 2016 election. It wouldn't have been possible
but
for
would
us.
Would it not be realistic to expect that your commitment in terms of delivery would be matched by the reality of being able to deliver that? That's only the point I'm making. And whether actually what you've established is that this consultation doesn't add anything, would seem to be suggesting. It's not providing protection because you can remove it. Why would you not then look at that in terms of primary and secondary schools as well?
Well, we have no plans to do that in relation to primary and secondary schools, and I don't think it's the case that it doesn't add anything. What we've done is listened to the views being fed back by local authorities in relation to concerns that they have around the truncated timescale that they would be forced to operate within were they to have to extend consultation requirements. That's the decision we've taken on the basis of that, but it's not, I don't think, a question of the value of consultation being devalued.
It's a constraint defined by a timetable established by the government itself. Can I ask one last question? Because this is something that's probably quite common in Glasgow. Forgive me if it's not common in other places. Very often now, more often than not, I think, nursery classes are located inside primary schools. So what would happen in a circumstance where there is a, and I think we would all be encouraging that idea of a campus approach, very often with, you know, additional support needs schools, a nursery and a primary on the one location. How does that, if the local authority was developing its part of its provision, and I accept there should be all this flexibility in that kind of campus, what would happen around the consultation there?
Perhaps I could pass to Jeff in relation to that.
Thank you, Minister. Yes, I mean, there are a number of areas where local authorities would need to seek clarification from their own legal teams. Because it would depend sometimes on the management, the future management arrangement of the new centre. But the way we've drafted these modifications is that we're trying to support local authorities to think flexibly and imaginatively about how they configure or reconfigure their early learning and childcare estate going forward towards 1140 hours. So, I mean, in some cases, if it's a relocation and the management stays in place, then it would be exempt from consultation. But if there are closures involved, then the consultation would have to apply. So it does depend on a number of factors, including the management arrangements for the centre going forward.
So what would your advice be to a local authority who is wanting to expand its childcare provision by establishing a campus which included a primary school and a nursery class?
Would
they have to consult or not?
Well, I think as Jeff has highlighted, it will be for local authorities to determine based on the advice that they receive from their own legal officers in relation to that.
So what would your advice be given that you've decided this order needs to go through?
Well,
would your advice
I don't think it's for me to issue advice to individual local authorities about the approach they take at a local level. What I'm doing is reacting to the correspondence and the conversations that we have had with local authorities about what they see as a requirement for them. So I think if local authorities were coming to us and saying, if you remove this suspension, it will create great difficulty for us, then we would have obviously thought very carefully about that. But what they've come to us and said is, we need you to continue the suspension beyond 31st March 2017 in order to enable us to undertake the changes that you wish to see. So we're reacting to what local authorities have been telling us.
Okay, Tavish, and then Liz.
John Lamont's coming back.
Okay,
thank you.
Liz.
Can I just do this point, Minister? I do think Joanne Lamont's made a very relevant point, because part of the consultation inevitably will be the concerns of parents who, you know, I think the transition between nursery and primary one and primary two is absolutely essential for many parents when they're making considerations about what they want. And you made the point that you thought that this would disapply to primary and secondary education. I'm not sure that it can, because what happens when the consultation provides quite a lot of evidence that is clear from nursery provision that actually has an effect, either through the campus setup that Joanne Lamont's described, or simply by making the point about the provision within a local authority. Have you thought that through?
I'm not sure I'm quite following where you're going.
The consultation will inevitably raise parental feedback as well as local and possibly teacher feedback about what I think is a very important issue in Scottish education, that tries to have a seamless transition between different stages. And the provision of nursery has a direct impact on what happens in the first stages of primary. and therefore it's almost certain to raise consultation issues about the overall provision. And I'm just not clear from your answers to Joanne Lamont, what you're saying just now, as to whether that's all been thought through.
So it has, and currently we obviously suspended these regulation, this requirement in the 2014 Act in order to enable the expansion to 600 hours. As part of the expansion to 1140 hours, we would be expecting and have seen already local authorities are undertaking consultation across their local authority area with parents in looking at what their likely requirements are going to be. So that is happening in terms of what parents want to see. In terms of when detailed proposals then emerge from local authorities, what we are saying is that instead of building in an additional 6 to 9 month consultation period around those detailed proposals, they should be, if they are going to involve, for example, constructions, then they would have to go through normal planning processes or extensions to buildings. But what we don't want to see is every single one of those proposals having to be delayed by a potential further 6 to 9 months, which would then impact on local authority timetables.
But you're absolutely confident that the proposal here ties in with existing legislation, are you?
Yes.
Okay.
Daniel, briefly.
So I understand the drive for this, but can you just confirm this is going to permanently change the right to consultation for parents? And can you just confirm that? And secondly, can you just state why it would be so detrimental to have to come back to the committee for a further extension if there was a time limit on this measure?
Well, to be clear, firstly, the right to consultation in relation to this has already been suspended, so it currently is not there. What we're dealing with is that you're right, not permanently, it would expire on the 31st of March this year. But what we are dealing with here is responses from local authorities stating to us that they require a further suspension in relation to that. But as I've already stated in my opening statement, in relation specifically to early learning centres, there are a number of other methods of consultation which exist, which will drive forward local authority planning in relation to early learning centres. And I would expect, you know, local authorities will, and I know local authorities have, been consulting with parents. What this does is it removes a 6 to 9 month statutory requirement around that so that local authorities can be more flexible in terms of their approach.
But if you needed more time, why would that be a problem to come back to the committee and seek a further extension if there's a time limit to this measure?
You mean if I was to say that we will only apply this
until
2020? Well, we've weighed it up and gone on balance and thought that, well, we might want to ensure that, as you know, I've just have been told that we should have planned for an open-ended approach to this in relation to the 31st March 2017 cut-off, because we didn't plan far enough ahead. So what we're doing with this is leaving it open to us to be able to have that further planning beyond 2020. But I've said to the committee that if I'm of the opinion that we need to come back and make a modification to the 2010 Act to reinsert those requirements, I will do so.
Thank you very much. We'll now move on to the next item, item 4, which is a formal debate on motion S5M. 03791 in the name of the Minister. I remind everyone that officials are not permitted to contribute to the formal debates, and I ask the Minister to move the motion.
Yeah, moved, Convener.
Thank you. I will now put the... Anybody get any questions? Right. I will now put the question to the committee that motion S5M 03791 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Agreed? Thank you. The committee must report to Parliament on this instrument. Are members content for me, as convener, to sign off a report? Thank you. Can I thank Mr. Maguire and Ms. Stirling for their attendance? I will now suspend for a moment to allow the officials to change over. Continuing Care Scotland Amendment Order 2017, and I welcome to the meeting alongside the Minister, Caroline Unay, Corporate Parenting and Formal Care Team Leader, and Liz Blair, Senior Principal Legal Officer of the Scottish Government. Again, I understand the Minister wishes to make an opening statement.
Thank you, Convener, for the opportunity to introduce this draft instrument before committee today. The Continuing Care Amendment Order amends Article 2 of the Continuing Care Scotland Order 2015 with the effect that from 1 April 2017, the higher age limit for eligible persons specified for the purposes of the Section 26A2B of the Children Scotland Act 1995 is increased from 18 to 19 years of age. This means that from 1 April, an eligible person for the purposes of the duty on local authorities to provide continuing care under Section 26A of the 1995 Act is a person who is at least 16 years of age and who has not yet reached the age of 19. By virtue of Article 3 of the 2015 Order, the local authority's duty to provide continuing care lasts from the date on which an eligible person ceases to be looked after until the date of their 21st birthday. In summary, Part 11 of the 2014 Act on Continuing Care and the accompanying secondary legislation stresses the importance of encouraging and enabling young people to remain in their care setting until they are able to demonstrate their readiness and willingness to move on to interdependent living. Interdependence more accurately reflects the day-to-day realities of an extended range of health interpersonal relationships, social support and networks. Continuing care undoubtedly normalises the experience of care-experienced young people in kinship, foster and residential care by allowing strong and positive relationships between young people and carers to be maintained and reducing the risk of multiple simultaneous disruptions occurring in their lives as they approach adulthood. This draft order is essentially a procedural amendment to increase the higher age limit for eligible persons from 18 to 19 years of age as part of an agreed annual rollout strategy, increasing the higher age range in step with the first eligible cohort of 16-year-olds until eventually the entitlement will cover all young people who cease to be looked after on or after their 16th birthday to remain in continuing care up to their 21st birthday. This draft order will revoke the Continuing Care Scotland Order 2016. Thank you.
Thank you. I've got no questions. Does anybody else have any questions for the Minister? Okay, in that case, we now move on to item 6, which is the formal debate on motion S5M03892 in the name of the Minister. Again, I will remind everyone that officials are not permitted to contribute to the formal debates, and I ask the Minister to move the motion.
Moved.
Thank you. I'll now put the question to the committee that motion S5M03892 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Thank you very much. As with previous instrument, the committee must report to Parliament. Are members content for me as convener to sign off on a report? Thank you. I now thank Minister Mark MacDonald and his officials for attendance, and will now suspend for a moment to allow the witnesses to change over. Thank you very much. Thank you. We now move on to agenda item 7, which is a roundtable discussion on the content and delivery of personal and social education. Before we start, I want to put on record my thanks to everyone who's contributed already to the committee's work on PSE. We've received hundreds of comments and submissions by email and social media, and members of the committee have also had discussions with young people and teachers on this topic. The level of response has been notable, and I thank in particular classes of students and schools, including Bearsden Academy, who have spent time in class workshopping what PSE should be about and have sent us pictures of the fruits of their labours. One of our witnesses, Janet Westwater, is from Bearsden Academy. She's the one with the big grin. Janet, please pass on our sincere thanks to the pupils. Roundtables are intended to promote more of a conversational style of evidence gathering as the committee is scoping the issues relating to PSE at this stage. That said, I'd remind everyone to indicate to me or the clerks if they would like to speak, and then I will call you. I suggest that we go round the table and briefly introduce ourselves. I'm James Dornan, MSP, and I'm the convener of the committee.
Joanne Lamont, MSP, deputy convener.
Ross Greer, MSP for the West of Scotland.
Janet Westwater, principal teacher of guidance at Bearsden Academy.
Claire Clark, Communications Director, Sex Expression UK.
Ross Thompson, Member of the Scottish Parliament for the North East of Scotland.
Colin Beattie, MSP for Midlothian, North and Musselburgh.
Daniel Johnson, MSP for Edinburgh Southern.
Hilary Kidd, Development Manager, Young Scots.
Eddie McCauley, Member of Scottish Youth Parliament and also a student teacher as well.
Jack Douglas, LGBT Plus Officer in UN Scotland.
I'm Tavish Scott, I'm the MSP for Shetland and I have teenage children at school. Too right.
I'm Gillian Martin. I'm the MSP for Aberdeenshire East. I also have teens at school and college, since Davish has started that off. I'd also like to declare that my husband is a PSE teacher and guidance teacher in Turniff Academy.
I'm Jordan Daly, the co-founder of the Time for Inclusive Education, or TIE campaign.
Joanna Barrett, policy manager at the NSPCC in Scotland.
Liz Smith, I'm a Conservative MSP for Mid Scotland and Fife.
Clare Adamson, MSP for Motherwell and Wishaw, and I have a team.
So, okay, thank you very much. I suggest that we start the discussion on the content of PSE, and a little later we can perhaps focus on more on how this content is delivered. The submissions indicated a desire for a great breadth of subjects to be taught in PSE, from financial planning to issues around mental health to sex education. It'd be helpful to know from our guest today how you think schools should go about identifying what to prioritise when teaching PSE, and I'm quite happy to let somebody catch my eye if they wish to start the proceedings. It's going to be a short meeting. Yeah. Okay, right, moving on to sex and relationships education then. Do we have the balance right in terms of talking about healthy relationships and what they look like, being inclusive for all different types of relationships and the biological mechanics of sex? Jordan.
Thanks. I think that one of the primary issues when it comes to relationships education in schools is that it isn't necessarily inclusive, and that's despite having frameworks and guidance in place, such as the relationship, sexual health and parenthood education, which was updated in 2014 to be LGBT inclusive. But behind actually having that guidance, there's issues as to how we get that guidance into school. So what's effectively happened up until now is that the Scottish Government has issued this guidance, recommended that it be taught or discussed or that teachers pick up on it, but never actually followed up to see if it is being picked up on, and never actually put a requirement there for it to be picked up on. So our research found that on our SHP, the majority of teachers had either never heard of or never read the guidance, and it was only 7% of teachers had actually been actively teaching it. And of course, as many of you will know, the issues around LGBT inclusivity within schools are very pressing. There are LGBT young people right across the country who are feeling excluded and marginalised, and I was one of them only a few years ago. I went to a school in North Lanarkshire and actually done PSE, and PSE for me was, like many of my fellow pupils, one of those waste of time subjects, to be frank. It was a subject where we knew that we would go and a video would be stuck on, or we would have a workbook to fill out about drugs and alcohol, and for my entire way through school that was primarily what we focused on, was drugs and alcohol awareness. There was nothing there about relationships at all, actually. very little sex education, and that could be partly because I went to a faith school. I can only speak to my experiences, but there was absolutely nothing on LGBT inclusivity, and indeed 86% of LGBT people who took part in our research in 2016 reported that LGBT issues were never discussed or taught in their schools, and only 5% actually felt that their teachers would have been adequately equipped to discuss issues. And that picture is quite consistent across all research and data that is available, is that LGBT inclusivity within school is definitely an issue, and I'm aware that there was a lot of submissions that verified that as well. So for us, it comes down to an issue of consistency. How do we get that guidance and those frameworks, which I personally think does have to be updated anyway? RSHP could be doing with being a little bit bulkier. We would argue that it's about putting that out with a requirement of uptake. I know that there's also quite a steady debate around whether or not PSE should be statutory within the curriculum. I think that there are ways that we can move around that and still allow flexibility for teachers within their schools. But for us, that is the clear problem, is there is no consistency in schools, and that does come down to the fact that this guidance is put out as a recommendation, and we need to kind of move beyond that language.
Okay, thank you very much for that. Clare, you wanted to come in.
So I am from Sex Expression UK, and what we do is we teach sex education to schools and in the community. I have personal experience of the Aberdeen area, which is where my branch is, and I found that teachers don't actually know how to teach anything about relationships because they're not told what to teach. They don't get any guidance on what to teach, so they actually have us come in, and we're covering issues like body image, healthy relationships, and consent. And consent seems to be like a massive thing that is not coming across to these young people. And I think this is like demonstrated by the fact that we're having to do consent classes at university. So we're clearly missing a gap. We're letting these people go, leave school, and they've got no information about consent. And then we're having to like cover up at university as well. Yep.
It's an old man talking, right? See when you say consent classes. Yeah.
So consent classes are, we kind of run workshops with groups of young people talking about what they think is like considered sexual consent. So not just verbal consent or like kind of like movements and body images that people could like body. Yeah, so it's more like understanding body language and understanding other people and the consent around like sex and relationships.
Yeah, right, okay, thank you. Janet, you wanted to come in.
I would say that within East Dunbartonshire, there's a sexual health programme laid out from S1 to S6. And there is flexibility within that, and we teach consent within the S4. And I think that's something that came through within the submissions to the committee, was the number of LGBT classes that pupils obviously seem to want. We've got a really good relationship with LGBT within East Dunbartonshire. Our S2 pupils get contact, but we've also got an equalities group currently running, and we're heading towards Purple Friday on Friday there. So it's a big issue for us, but I do think you're right, yes, for more materials to be coming through on LGBT, but also mindful of, we're really lucky in our school that our principal teachers of guidance teach their caseload. So we teach our caseload from S1 all the way through to S6, but that is not necessarily the case all the way through Scotland. So to have principal teachers of guidance who have contact with their children 1 to 2 periods a week is a positive, I think, because they're building that relationship. And teaching something like consent or sexual health or LGBT issues is a complex thing, and you need to be skilled within that, and I think principal teachers of guidance are best placed to be teaching that just now.
Okay, thank you. Jack, and then Hilary.
Just to go on to those points about consent that Clare brought up, there was a really interesting study done by Terry and Higgins Trust in 2016, and it confirmed that only, I think it was only 75% of young people said that they had not learned about consent in PSE lessons, which is just an absolutely shocking figure. And it shows, it was a UK-wide study right enough, but it shows how much of an issue that the lack of consent and how it's taught about in pre-16 education is a huge issue. But also just to touch on the LGBT side of it as well, Section 28 was abolished, I think, about 17 years ago, but its effects in education is still very much there. it's still there. About 50% of young people in the study that I just mentioned rated their PSE education as either poor or terrible, and the worst results were amongst people that were trans. And as someone who's trans myself, I had a very different experience to what Jordan had. I wasn't in a religious school, but we did have relationship and sexual health education, but it was done in an entirely heteronormative and cisgendered way. So it just wasn't relevant to me in any way whatsoever. So really, from NUS Scotland's point of view, this has to change, and it has to come in some form of statutory, so it's a high quality level across Scotland, not just in certain parts.
Okay, thank you, Jack. Helen?
Hello. Interestingly, Young Scot was commissioned by the Scottish Government's Creating a Healthier Scotland Joint Improvement Team. Now, this was to provide, to involve young people in the national conversation of the future of health and social care. And as part of that, we supported a youth investigation team comprising of young people aged between 15 and 23 who did research that was presented to the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Wellbeing. And one of the key themes, despite the fact this was about that issue, was education. And the recommendation, interestingly, was to change the delivery structure and content of the PSE and PE curriculums in Scottish secondary schools to ensure all young people are equipped with the knowledge and tools to live healthy lives. One of the key reflections raised by young people within this, around this issue, was, and I'll word this exactly, PSHE, so there's something around terminology there, how we're describing the subject, but PSHE does not properly address topics surrounding sex, gender, and sexuality as they are seen as uncomfortable to talk about. And I think that's something that's been reflected by everyone who's spoken so far. Taking a slight step back in terms of delivery, at Young Scot, we believe in co-design, so involving young people from the very beginning, and that involves young people systematically co-creating, co-producing, co-designing, co-delivering solutions, and I think that's something we feel quite strongly about in relation to all topics like this. So engaging young people at the very beginning around delivery of something like this.
Okay, Liz, and then Erin.
I mean, some schools have done some fantastic work and have very strong committees on these issues that involve pupils and parents and staff. Is there any evidence that when you have that kind of committee structure in a school, that things are better, or is there no evidence to support that?
I think there needs to be ongoing support for schools when they're introducing these issues. And I think our equalities group is currently quite new. So we're working with LGBT to build this. And I think if you build a culture within your school that LGBT is the norm, it's, you know, it's part of what's going to be on the curriculum, everybody's going to teach it, everybody's going to know, everybody's going to be comfortable, everybody should be comfortable. But more importantly, the teachers need the support in delivering it. As we've said, I think the support is the main thing that we need to be looking at there.
Thank you.
Okay,
yeah, just from a Scottish Youth Parliament point of view, like, it's really, really clear across the whole of Scotland. Time and time again, the Scottish Youth Parliament get motions put forward on better sex education, and I think it's very clear as well that not just the young people in Scotland don't feel equipped, but they don't feel their teachers are equipped. And that is a very, very big effect, because if their teacher is not confident on what to teach or is confident about talking about relationships or sex education, then that is having a profound effect on how they are taking that on. And that is very clear. That's what's been expressed to us, that not just they don't feel equipped, but they don't feel that their teachers are confident to talk about it. And also what's been expressed by a lot of young people that we've spoke to is that there's not much emphasis on the emotional side to sex education. It's pretty done by the book, and that is it. There is no really a follow-up or the kind of emotional aspect, and it's still this embarrassment and stigma around sex education. So there is a massive call. Time and time again, we get motions on better sex education. We don't feel equipped. And I think that is quite worrying.
Okay, thank you very much for that. Sorry, you want to come in briefly and then Ross?
The last point I would say is a couple of years ago we brought in the six-year lesson on kind of the six-year holiday. This is something that's becoming a little bit more in schools where 6 years are going away on holiday. They are away to wherever they're going. And our 6 years responded really well to that. And they said that was information that they wanted. What does happen when they go away? And I think by equipping our fifth and 6 years with a little bit more knowledge about out with the school bubble, as it were, I think that's a really positive, and that's one thing that did come back in evaluations.
My grandson is going in that 6 year holiday, so maybe after this we can have a wee chat. Ross.
Yeah, thanks so much. I feel I should start off by almost declaring an interest as a former pupil of Bearsden Academy, but just before Janet's time. But it's just within the first 10 minutes here, we identified some really significant gaps around sex and relationship education not being inclusive of LGBT young people, of things like consent being missing for the overwhelming majority of young people. So I'd just like to ask, to drill down on that a little bit more, what are the consequences? What are the consequences of LGBT young people not being included in sex ed in school? What are the consequences of most young people not learning about consent and universities having to offer it? What happens?
Okay. Oh, no, on you go, Claire, and then
right.
Jordan, you
from the consent side of view, we think, like, if you teach people about consent, we're not just saying, like, we're not just talking about rape, we're talking about how they respect for themselves. So people that go to university, like I'm a fourth year student myself, you go to university, you're kind of like in this world, you're in this bubble, you feel like you've just left school, you can do what you want, and they don't have any background to what they should be doing, how to keep themselves safe, and also they don't have any respect for themselves or others. So in Aberdeen, we did find that there was a kind of missing gap of people not knowing where consent was, people thinking that, oh, it was okay to go and grope someone in a nightclub because they'd never been told that was wrong, or like more serious consequences. So what we did was we brought in, like you did for your sixth year holiday, but we did it for like the massive ski trip that happened at Aberdeen University, and we spoke to everyone that was on that and did like a kind of scenario-based consent class where we showed them videos and got them to discuss in small groups about what they thought was consent, and we mixed up the groups so there was a mix of like girls and guys, and there were like both talking about what they both thought, so like there was difference of opinions, so it was kind of like a group learning situation, so everyone was involved in it, but from speaking to the people there, they thought this should have been delivered earlier, they shouldn't be in first and second year of university at 18, 19 and just finding out that this is wrong when they've been like kind of like living alone for 2 years. So if this is taught earlier on, people have more respect for themselves, and this isn't just to do with kind of like consent and rape, it's to do with the relationships and having like knowing what's right in your relationship and knowing what you want from a relationship. So that's also covered in consent, so that people aren't pressured into feeling like they have to be in relationships or they have to do this, they have to do that at university. And this also covers things like peer pressure for drugs and alcohol. So I do feel that it's something that is missing and is something that's required in under 16 year education.
Jordan, you were wanting to respond to this.
Yeah, I'm going to break just down in two, because I'm going to respond to Lizzie's question and then Ross, if that's all right, because Liz asked the question about the having equalities in LGBT committees in school. So in terms of quantitative data and like kind of numerical statistics, the whole kind of phenomenon of having an LGBT committee or group of equality within the school is relatively recent in most of the schools that have them. So as far as we're aware, there hasn't actually been any data done on what the impact of the committees are. However, there is anecdotal data, there's qualitative data. If you visit some of the schools that have these committees, they are in the minority, unfortunately, but schools such as the Vale of Leaven Academy in Dumbarton, Ross Hall Academy, Bannerman High School, we go into schools regularly. In fact, every week we're in different secondary schools and we do school assemblies and we work with some of the young people, and we see the impact of these committees. And it's more than just about having a safe space, so to speak, in the school where young LGBT people can go, but it's about empowering the young LGBT people themselves to actively campaign within their school. And so that increases their confidence, that helps them educate their own peers. But then I would also caution on placing too much emphasis just on having a committee, because that's, I think, relying on one or two teachers and the young people to change the entire ethos of their school. This does need to come from a national level. The big problem is consistency. This is a unique opportunity that we have to look into how is this being delivered in our school? How is PSE being delivered? How are teachers equipped to deal with the issues that they're presented with in an ever-changing society? We do need to do more for a national approach and stop saying that it's the local authority's responsibility or it's the school's responsibility. It's when it comes to things like equalities and human rights and the treatment of LGBT young people, it is actually the responsibility of our government. We have an Equality Act. We have the UN Rights of the Child. It's national responsibility to ensure that they are enforced and consistent within schools. On Ross's point as to what are the consequences of this kind of gap around LGBT inclusivity within schools, most of you will be aware of the statistics that we uncovered. 90% of LGBT young people experience homophobia, biphobia and transphobia in school. 27% have attempted suicide as a result of bullying once, and a further 15% have tried more than once. We constantly hear about self-harm, feelings of isolation. When I was in first year of school, I wanted to kill myself because of the way that I felt and the lack of support that was available at my school. By not being included within your school environment, by not being able to learn from people that you rely on learning from, your teachers, by not feeling as though you can ask your school for help, which I certainly couldn't. Some of the things that I used to hear from teachers in my school, and bear in mind that I only left school 3 years ago, was appalling, actually, and now I wish I'd understood the Equality Act when I was at school. But by feeling like you're so isolated in school, there are individual implications and there are social implications. And on the concept of sex education, I hope my mum is not watching this live, but I became sexually active when I was a senior in school. And obviously as a gay man, I was sexually active with another man. And I had been through, at this point, 5 years of supposed sex and relationships education in my school, and at 17 years old, when I first became sexually active, I thought that HIV was curable. I thought that HIV was like gonorrhea or chlamydia, where you could treat it with pills. So that's 17 years old, now sexually active, had sex education in the Scottish school system and thought that HIV was curable, had absolutely no idea. And again, that's only 4 years ago. So that, I think, in itself tells you quite a lot about what's happening in schools when it comes to sex education. But there is an obvious elephant in the room around faith schools and the kind of position over what faith schools are prepared to teach within their schools. I don't think it's acceptable to continue to allow for opt-outs on moral grounds. At the end of the day, there are LGBT young people within faith schools. They have the same right to an inclusive education as everyone else, and that definitely does need to be discussed.
Okay, thank you very much for that. Erin, Jack, Hillary, and then I need to bring in Tavish. It's all round about this point, Tavish, that's why I
echo Jordan's point in regards to faith schools. I personally went to a faith school and I certainly didn't feel informed or educated when I went to university, so I just wanted to echo Jordan's point. But also before I come back to Ross, I think like it is important as well to recognise that some of the views that we get coming into the Scottish Youth Parliament, yeah, they are pretty negative towards PSE, but there is also some really, really good things going on. And I think it's important to recognise that some PSE sessions are really great, and it's how you actually ensure that that is consistent across the full of Scotland, because there's some young people that speak to us and say, I really like my PSE class, my teacher's great, you know, it's really informative, but there's others like, no, it's just a waste of time, there's no point, I don't go. So I think obviously consistency is really, really important. And coming back to Ross's point on the consequences, I don't think it can be stressed enough that early intervention is so important. To prevent consequences in the first place. You talked about people going to university. Not every young person is going to university, and that's a consequence in itself. Not every young person has that opportunity of, if they're not getting that education at school, then they might not ever get the education ever again. And obviously, education is one of the biggest powerful tools you can ever use. So I think getting a PSE system that is well-equipped for modern-day society, and that actually includes young people, and engages young people. That's why we believe that the Scottish Youth Parliament, that young people should actually be part of forming the PSE sessions to actually ensure that when they're engaged in it and what they're learning is what they kind of feel that they need. But I think early intervention is really, really, really important before, so the consequences don't arise.
Just to respond to 2 points, first is Ross's point about what are the direct consequences in this. A report done by NUS Scotland a couple of years ago, we looked into what we determine as LAD culture, and what we found is 1 in 5 students face some form of sexual harassment during their first term. And that could be anything from sexual comments to wolf whistling to outright sexual assault within a student's very first term at being college or university, and that's a direct consequence of not discussing consent in PSE, in pre-16 education. I also want to sort of say well done to the TAI campaign and the fantastic report they did in 2016. For me, looking at that report, there's two big figures that jump out at me. The first one is that 90% of LGBT people have experienced homophobia, biphobia and transphobia at school. And the other one is 87% of teachers hear homophobic, biphobic or transphobic language at school. Those are incredibly high percentages. That, like, it's a significant majority there, and almost, like, if you are LGBT, it is almost incredibly likely that you are going to face some form of discrimination at your school. So I would say that these are the direct consequences of the lack of inclusive PSE lessons in school. To go back to the point about stigma, though, what we find is stigma is drastically shaping PSE lessons. For example, we're still seeing anti-choice speakers and organisations come into schools and try and shame the idea of relationships or sex, and as a result try and promote abstinence, which often creates a hell of a lot more problems than solutions. And what we also find is, because it's mostly down to local authorities and head teachers how this is shaped, we find that actually, depending on what their viewpoints are on equality, shapes this as well. So it's not only, it's harming lots and lots of students in this, because it's not statutory.
Okay, thank you for that. Hilary.
Hi, I'm just picking up on a very specific point made by Jordan in his excellent comments, and that was around consistency. In the Creating a Healthier Scotland report by young people, the young people interestingly noted that whilst a new curriculum should be mandatory for all pupils in Scotland, like RE, that was the comparison made by them, not just in S3 and S4. They did specifically say that the curriculum should be flexible to tackle local issues, because the issues facing a young person in Glasgow are not necessarily the same in Thurso, for example. And I think that's probably a key element of speaking about consistency, thinking about the importance of that flexibility, but still covering the key issues that are important to young people.
I'd like to bring in Tavish at this point, and I know Clare and others want to come in, but Tavish.
Thank you. I just should reassure Jordan that most MSPs still worry about their mother watching this as well. So don't.
I was thinking exactly.
Don't at all worry about what you might say in committee. I've just got two questions for this brilliant panel that have been assembled today. Quite a number of you have talked about who is teaching PSE. My straw poll of this was at a swimming gala on Sunday at home in Shetland, where I talked to lots of mums and dads my age, all worried about kids' online bullying, sexting, what's going on in school to deal with that, should they ban mobile phones from schools, should we be doing something about the mobile phone companies, who after all are just in it for money. That's all a bit of a sideshow, but what I really would be interested in is your take on who are the best folk to actually deliver relationship and sex education. The suggestion that was made to me very well, I thought, on Sunday by quite a number of mums was, we've got really good youth workers around schools. Why don't youth workers who are genuinely a little closer to young people do this work? I'd just be interested in the thoughts of this great group of people we've got here today.
You're obviously not including the MSPs in that.
I'm certainly not including the MSPs in that, no.
Okay. Joanna, do you want to come in on this one?
There's a range of people who need to be involved in this, because this is not about your 2 hours or your 1 hour a week. The message you can give, the most consistent messages and the most equal messages in that class, but then that's not reinforced potentially in school policies or how bullying or incidents are dealt with. It's not it's maybe undermined by messages that children are getting in the media about
women and body image and various other things. So I don't think that it's fair necessarily just to focus on teachers, and we know the teachers that we've spoken to are really struggling in these issues, and CPD budgets are being cut. They really feel that they are being left to deal with, you know, the kind of last bastion of all the social issues under the sun, and they're just not equipped to deal with it. Another point I would like to make, which doesn't necessarily answer that, but it's just we've talked a lot about secondary. We've declared to teenagers, I'm going to declare 3 under 5, hence the bags under my eyes. I've got 3 children under 5. And this is an issue that affects them and will affect them through primary school as well. And we need to sow the seeds of respect for yourself and dignity for yourself and others at primary school. And I don't necessarily know that we've even started to look at that. I mean, we offer a programme for primary 1 to 7s about how to recognise abuse and what to do about it in a very safe and engaging and age-appropriate way. But I just wanted to underline that this is not a teenage subject matter. This is about the whole of childhood and the whole of the curriculum.
Okay, right, thank you. Clare.
So, Sexpression UK is, and obviously we're all students teaching, so we kind of like preach that we're a near peer organisation, and we feel this is really, really useful for kids because, one, they're not having the same teacher that they're going to have for maths, or having a kind of like dedicated person who they feel they can talk to because they're of a similar age, they've had similar experiences. Because when I taught my first sex education lesson, I was still 17. So I was teaching people that were maybe 3 or 4 years younger than me. I'd just gone through the school system. So I think having somebody like a youth worker come in and do it, where they can be specialised in doing it, they know exactly what they're talking about, and they've got the evidence behind them, rather than a teacher who's overworked, who maybe their speciality isn't something like PSE. They don't have like enough time, because I understand it's a very demanding job. My mum is a teacher herself. And if you've got somebody that's an expert in this coming in to speak to the kids are going to relate more to them rather than somebody they'll see, or they're going to be able to ask some questions they might not be able to ask their teacher. Also, what you said about your kids who are under 5, I recently taught in a primary 6 class, and I noticed we're doing an LGBT lesson with them, and I noticed they were using kind of what I would call casual homophobic terms, and they had no idea this was wrong because they'd heard it in the playground and they'd never been told this was wrong. So we're letting these kids get to like 10, 11 and not realising this is wrong. It should be something that's dealt with from an earlier stage, rather than kind of like, especially with sex education, if we're just leaving this to secondary school, you're going to bombard them with so much information. They've all got their exams going on. They've got other things to worry about. And they're not going to have any time. They're going to say their PSE lessons are a waste of time when they could be doing other things. Another point that was raised was faith schools. I myself also went to a faith school, and I love my school. I'm not going to slag my school, but we didn't get any sex education, and it was delivered in the RE department. We were given a textbook, and like glossed over anything about contraception, anything about anything that could be controversial, and this isn't an appropriate way for anyone to learn. So even if you are in a non-denominational school and given a textbook, or a teacher is putting a condom in a banana, no one's going to learn from that. So we think our lessons at Sexpression UK are, they're activities, they're getting people engaged in their activities, they're allowed to talk, discuss, learn from each other, and we feel that's a much more valuable experience for the pupils, and they will probably learn more in the hour we spend with them than they would if they were given a book.
Okay. There's a number of people wanted to come in on that, but I want to bring in Gillian. She's been waiting to speak for a wee while and see.
Even since I sort of caught your eye, I've got even more questions, but I think...
Well, don't think you're getting to say them.
I know. I think this thing about how are teachers equipped is key to this. And I suppose my questions for the people who are actually delivering PSE, and obviously I can talk to my own source on this as well, and I have talked to him, but it does seem to be fairly patchy, the quality. So I think I've got two questions. How is good practice shared? Is it shared? What would you like to see happen in the sharing of that good practice and ideas? And another thing that's come out to me as well is about not just in PSE, but through the school curriculum, having a normalisation of talking about sex through the types of maybe literature that we're looking at in English, the kind of art we study, the kind of history we study, and just having it absolutely permeating through the entire school curriculum, so that it's not just the guidance teacher that's the person that you go to and you can talk to about these issues, but it's right throughout other areas of the curriculum. I wonder what you would think about that.
Come with Janet first.
I think that's a really good point about who's teaching it, first of all. We know in Besden it's the principal teacher guidance, but we love to have visiting specialists. And what we find is it's actually really difficult sometimes to get a good coverage of specialists based on time. So within the constraints of a school timetable, if you have maybe two S1 PSE classes, period one on a Monday morning, followed by the next two PSE classes just before lunch on a Wednesday, and then the other two at the end of a Friday. If we're asking people to come in and we're saying, right, could we get you just to come in at 9 o'clock and then a couple of days later, it's really, really difficult for charities, agencies to give up their time in order to do that. But we have found when that time is available and when those resources are available, that is a really good, is a valuable resource for us to have, because not only are the teachers learning from being in that class and we're gaining extra information from them, and it's like a mini CPD, but also our pupils, the impact on our pupils is much greater, because then even if they come in, deliver that, we can then pursue the lessons further, and it just takes one session. We did a cascade with LGBT, so we have taken LGBT materials and then use them across different year groups as well. So that does work, that model does work, and I would say within time constraints, cost constraints, that's worth it. I'm a principal teacher of guidance. I teach PSE, but I also teach drama. I have a 10-period teaching commitment within drama as well. So I think we need to be mindful that within guidance in my school, we've got modern studies, we've got history, we've got drama, we've got English, we've got quite a number of subject specialists as well coming through. But what we found is, since I've come to Besden, we teach an anti-bullying unit through drama, and our PSE, you know, through cascading that, our PSE is covered through S1 through drama, and that's quite good in the classroom as well. So I would definitely say that if we can get more time, more money for agencies to help us deliver that, that would be good.
Okay, thank you. Erin, then Hilary, and then Jordan.
I think specialists are a really, really key part on delivering specific things in PSE, and I think it is that young people maybe feel that they can express their views better to them because they're not seeing that person every single day. But one thing I would say is that I know, again, in my own personal experience, a specialist would come in, be great, but then there was no follow-up. There was no resources for the teacher after that, or what happens next? Okay, we've just learned about this thing, and then what? What happens then? And in regards to Gillian's point, I think that's really, really important, because now at the Scottish Youth Parliament, our campaign is mental health, and that's something we are really trying to push people around this table to endorse, that mental health should be a core part of the curriculum for excellence, not just in PSE, but in modern studies and English and PE. And I think there's a lot of things that should be cross-curricular rather than just focused on PSE, talking about loads of different things in every subject, and given the empowerment of teachers across every subject, not just in guidance, to try and help shape a lot of the issues, because there's so many issues and I don't think that it can be covered in PSE.
That's you, that, to be fair, we are here to discuss PSE, right? But and you have been doing a lot of work in mental health. Yeah. How do you see PSE being used better to help promote good work in regards to mental health?
I think there is a long, long way to go in regards to mental health, and our campaign really does highlight that. About 73% of young people don't know their local where their local support services are. But again, I do think that comes back to a lot of teachers don't know what language they should use in terms of triggers. So in order to have a great curriculum that promotes mental health, again, teachers also need to feel that they are confident to speak about it first for them, for their point of view as well. But I think mental health is something that we are definitely pushing for in the curriculum for excellence, and it's something that a lot of young people are feeling and something that they've been saying. And I know this is not about attainment, but a lot of people have been saying that they generally do believe that how their mental health is really, really affecting their attainment. Like, how can they possibly be expected to meet these standards when their emotional well-being is not being met at school?
Yeah, I think that's a fair point. Hilary, do you want to come in? And if anybody wants to sort of like link up the whole discussion we've been having so far with the mental health, because there's clearly links for lots of kids, then that'd be helpful for you as well.
I think we're in quite an interesting place within Young Scot, where we sit at the moment with 650,000 card holders, as well as 2 million page requests in our digital content. Now, the digital platform provides universal, bespoke, and targeted information on a wide range of topics, and that's from personal well-being through to physical and mental health in relation to that, from hygiene, friendships, relationships, and so on and so forth. And we do work with other partners, so Choices for Life, and that includes information for teachers and how to kind of teach drugs and alcohol-related issues. And we also work with other stakeholders to ensure there's a single destination for information for young people. So we have a role to promote that further amongst teachers and pupils. But we also do it through social platforms, recognising where young people are really consuming content. So Snapchat, Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, really engaging, exactly as Tavish Scott had said. We obviously would welcome the opportunity to work with PSE teachers and others across Scotland to really improve that and engage with them. So I think that's definitely a further stage for Young Scot to support that more.
Thank you. John?
Again, I'm going to try and very quickly go through a couple of points that have been brought up. So Gillian's point about who should deliver it, I think that it's about finding the right balance between teachers and external organisations. So in our strategy paper, we speak at length about the role that external groups can play. And what we do when we go into schools is we deliver assemblies for entire year groups, and we generally go into a school for the full day and get every single pupil, and that's it, done for the day. And of course, we follow up on that. But fundamentally, it is about teacher training, because it can't be left to external organisations, because like Erin's already said, we, first of all, we're not in a position where we can, like a teacher, have a constant relationship with a pupil, but we also can't continually go back into the same school throughout the year. So it is about teacher training. It's about making sure that there is a consistent level of teacher training. I know there's an argument that is made that we can't make things mandatory in the curriculum, but we can make teacher training mandatory. We can do it through ITE. We can have career-long professional teacher training. And when it comes to teacher training, if we can get the teachers trained, and we would initially argue that guidance teachers and teachers and promoted posts should be targeted first with an eventual view of all teachers, but if we can get teacher training right, then at least you have a solid base of teachers who are trained and who are equipped with the right kind of guidance to actually discuss this, and then they themselves or the schools can get in other organisations. But we need to have a good base. How that teacher training is delivered when it comes to LGBT, we're arguing that it needs to be free of charge. There is no point charging a school £500, £600, £700 to get their teachers trained. We can't be charging schools £100 or £200 a teacher to get trained, because, like it's already been mentioned, CPD budgets are being cut. Schools will not prioritise this if they have to pay hundreds of pounds to get their teachers trained. So we are exploring how this can be done at a national level. How can we ring fence funding, or how can we fill in the blank that training organisations would have, the deficit per se, if they were to provide their training free of charge. We do teacher training. We do teacher training for primary teachers, secondary teachers, and teachers in the additional support needs sector, which is also another key point, and I'll probably just email in the committee after that to discuss that. But it is about teacher training. It is about making sure that all teachers receive that training, and it's about making sure that that's free of charge. If we can get teacher training right, if we can get guidance right, then we'll have a good base in schools which external organisations can then come in and fill.
Okay, right. Thanks for that. Jack, and then Claire.
Yeah, just to go on from about the content or the teacher training with us, is I would say it really needs to be advanced. It doesn't only need to be inclusive, but it has to be advanced as well. If it's not advanced, then it's impossible for it to be inclusive. So for example, if I use the example of the differences between gender or sex, it's often, when it is taught in schools, it's often taught in a binary manner, both in sex and in gender. And what we find is that often fails, not only does it fail binary, non-binary trans people, but also fails intersex people as well, who don't fit into that terminology of male or female, and that needs to be fixed. And some would say that that's a very complicated subject for young people, but I would disagree with that statement altogether. It's I would say it's down to the people who are teaching it, and maybe that they don't feel confident in teaching it, maybe they don't feel that they feel worried that they're going to either offend or harm by teaching it, or say something wrong accidentally, or it's down to their viewpoints. And to come on to, like, we talked a little bit about external organisations coming in, I would just say that we need to be really careful of that, and really careful about the content of external organisations coming into schools as well, just to make sure that it is not a stigmaed environment, and it's a safe environment that people can feel proud about their relationships and proud about their sexuality and gender. And that is really important for an inclusive PSE lesson and education in general.
Thank you, Claire.
Yep. So, obviously going into schools and teaching sex education, I speak to a lot of teachers, and they've got a kind of fear over speaking about certain issues, like LGBT issues, because they're scared they offend and they don't have a kind of background information about it. I thought this fear was just for kind of established teachers, but actually when I was last year, I did a course, a 6-week course in teaching, and I was speaking to people who are going to be graduating as teachers in a year or two time, and they still had this fear, and they have grown up in an environment where they have had, like, Facebook, Snapchat, Twitter, because there's 20, 21-year-olds, but they still don't know what they should be saying to pupils. They also don't know, when it comes to things like safe sex and contraception, what they say to children, because obviously there's parents involved in that as well, and you don't know what background people have. So I think if it was something that was mandatory, people would feel more confident talking about it, because then they would have a background to fall back on, saying, that's actually part of our curriculum, that's what we have to speak about, and there'd be less of a kind of fear and stigma over teachers talking about this.
Okay, that's a very good point. But Joanna, and then Joanne.
I think there's a job to do, and I would be really keen to see the committee do it, and actually just finding out what is going on in terms of PSE, because we all have knowledge of our own bit of it, we've done some research, we have anecdotal kind of knowledge, but overall, we don't know what consistency is, we don't know how teachers feel, we don't know who delivers it. Fundamentally, we don't know what children and young people want to talk about, and that's where we should start, you know. And for us, it should be an open and discursive curriculum, because it should provide space for children and young people to talk about, raise queries about whatever kind of queries they have. And another, I read in some of the evidence, somebody raised the question about how evidenced is what we do, and I think that's a fantastic question. How do we know that what we are delivering is actually having an impact on children and young people's knowledge, behaviours and outcomes? So there is a role for ramping this up nationally. I mean, in the UK, the NSPCC's really championed mandatory PSHE in England and elsewhere. And as Jordan's mentioned, there's a bit of our curriculum, none of it's mandatory. And I'm personally getting to the point where, is that a good enough answer? You know, because our first question as people in public service who are thinking about children's rights is, what is in the best interest of children? And I think that should be where we're coming from, rather than what's mandatory and what's not, because the evidence today has shown that we are doing children and young people a disservice in hiding away, shying away, not talking about different issues. And we're seeing, certainly from Childline, we're seeing loads of calls, 60,000 last year, about peer-on-peer abuse, and really concerned about interpersonal relationships, largely from teenagers. So, and there's been an inquiry at Westminster about sexual harassment and bullying in schools in England, which found huge levels of sexual harassment and bullying. There are things going on in young people's relationships that we need to better equip them for.
Okay, thank you very much for that, Joanne.
Yeah, thanks very much. I mean, I suppose I should declare an interest as in the past as a school teacher, but I stopped teaching in 1999, and in 2000, this Parliament tried to get rid of Section 2A, and the world fell on our heads. So that's the context in which, how much progress we've made, which should make us optimistic. So the young people I was teaching in 1999 would not have the language that you have even to be able to, or have a platform to talk about these things, and I think we should recognise that progress and thank the young people who have had the courage through time to raise these issues and challenge people. And it's not just about, obviously, the LGBT issues, but actually attitudes to women 20 years ago would be massively different. And I can't tell you how profoundly depressed I am that somebody gets a second year at university and hasn't worked out that it's not a good idea to grope someone. And that's a broader question, I think, that we need to deal with. And I suppose my question is the extent to which we focus on PSE, and is there something deeper there? And be clear about what are the limits on PSE as well. I mean, when I was still teaching, we called it PSD, which is personal social development, which actually I think I prefer. In a school which was very radical in the question, the classes were half sizes, so you only had groups of 10, and it was pupil-led, so they kind of determined what they were talking about. I think it would be an interesting exercise to do a bit of an audit on what PSE looks like now in the context of cut budgets and other pressures. And I suppose the other point I would make is I agree very much with Gillian's point about a lot of this is in the... I think a lot of it is about relationships. So when I was still an English teacher, a lot of the literature you were working on, that's exactly what it's about. It's about life. So how confident is a school teacher to be able to draw out those kinds of lessons from what's in there? So I think that, again, is not just about PSE and narrowing that focus, but saying this is actually about something broader. But I suppose the last point, I'd be interested in this, from our witnesses here today. It seems to me there's a balance between allowing a conversation and opening up a conversation and encouraging young people to discuss their feelings. However, there is a question where the school ethos identifies things that are unacceptable, because some of it's not just an ignorance and a lack of awareness, but somebody who's actively willing to be homophobic or anti-women or racist. And the school ethos has to understand that's not, there's certain things that are unacceptable. And I wonder where you think that balance lies in terms of the role of a school. It's not just about educating about things that are wrong, but actually creating a context for that as well.
Erin, you wanted to come in, would you like to?
So I think probably on a more positive note, because it seems to be quite obviously negative, but I'm training to be a teacher right now, so I'm going through the system, and I think something I do find quite worrying is that I've left school, so I've only come out of school 2 years and now I'm trained to be a teacher, and the point that I'm at right now is that I've not felt equipped in terms of a lot of things like sex education and some basic stuff, even financial skills and things like that, to then be expected to go on and take all this into consideration in a teacher training programme. But I think one positive thing I would say is that going through the programme right now, I can see that there has been quite a positive shift. We are learning about how to, you know, inclusive education, we're talking about mental health more, and I think that is a really good thing, that a lot of the student teachers who are going through the programme right now are getting that sort of education. But I think it's balancing the teachers who are in, who've been there for years, to people like myself who are coming through, and balancing that old and new is something that's not quite there yet. But I think in terms of what PSE should look like as well, I think it should be a discussion. Like you were saying, I think young people feel like they're being lectured more than actually, can I ask this question to you? This is an opportunity as young people to discuss the issues that we are really, is burning in our heads, and more a kind of open forum of what are we discussing rather than lectured. So that's also something that's came to the Scottish Youth Parliament, that PSE should be a discussion rather than just a lecture of a subject.
I wondered if you agreed with the observation, however, that school teachers themselves can be the victims of these circumstances, either as a woman can be quite intimidated if the language in the school is unacceptable, or I had a colleague who was gay, now we are talking many years ago, but the focus for him and the amount of bullying he suffered and the lack of support it got, I think, was quite significant as a professional. I don't know if that's still an issue. I wondered more generally, what's your view of EIS has given us evidence that basically their view is that it shouldn't be prescriptive, and that we should be empowering staff to develop the curriculum. And I think these are people who are obviously committed to proper support for our young people. I wonder what your view is of that.
Janet, do you want to come in?
I wanted to tell you a little bit about our model at Bisden. So our first years have two periods of PSE a week.
One is PSE, one is transition, because we're still mindful that that transition from primary to secondary is still taking a little bit of getting used to. So those transition lessons and lessons about the community and their environment around them still go on there until about October, November time, where we kind of merge then into two periods of PSE. And they look at the S1 profile. We are launching and have launched My Merit for the use of the achievement profile online, and they are logging all their achievements and kind of celebrating success through PSE, which is, I think, a really positive thing. That relationship starts early on and you're celebrating success with your young people about the learning that's going on in other classrooms and drawing that cross-curricular in, therefore knowing what everybody else is doing within their classrooms. And you can feed into that within that time frame. S2, one period, S3, one period, S4, and then S5 and 6 also get a dedicated period of PSE with us, and that is solely looking just now UCAS, college, but also dipping into mental health, which is something that they've brought to us, sexual health, for example, a six-year holiday, and any other kind of issues. We've got SAS coming in. We work with Teenage Cancer Trust, and they come in and speak to us as well. We had Anthony Nolan in last week, and if you follow our Twitter feed, you'll see. And Twitter is something that we are introducing from more a pupil voice kind of angle, as you'll see on the evidence. We did in S1 and 2 a wee snapshot of what do you think PSE should be about? And they all came back and they were all really positive about having that discussion. And this is what pupils want. They want to be actively involved. Speaking to a fifth year class yesterday, so next year you'll be doing your UCAS, we will guide you. We use that one period a week to guide them between kind of August to November, December, when they're filling out their UCAS and they're filling out their college applications, when they're thinking about their positive destinations, and we use that to, you know, good effect. But also, what else do you want? And they say, we are not equipped to go out into the big wide world and look at buying a house, finance, mortgage, setting up a proper bank account, not just my squirrel or whatever they've still got. And they say that these are all issues of the day that they're not getting anywhere else, and they want it from PSE. So that's something that we are able to look at within my school, and I would hope that other schools would be able to do that as well and actually ask their students and tweet about what is current and what they are doing in PSE and their learning, because I think that's a great conversation to have. And I would also say that with the Shinari indicators coming through from primary, we're seeing that, yes, they are using the Shinari indicators, and we're asking them, as soon as they come in, we are kind of having that first year interview with them. How are you feeling? Are you feeling safe? They score it a 1 to 5, and we'll do that again at the end of their first year. So we can kind of gauge that if there is somebody that's struggling, if there is somebody who's not quite transition properly into secondary, then we can pick up with that. We weren't lucky enough to be able to keep our school counsellor, but we wish we were. I think maybe in Ross's time we had a school counsellor, but unfortunately that service was cut, and that's something that we are feeling with more and more mental health issues coming through in our young people, and self-harm becoming a little bit more kind of prevalent within our society, and stress and anxiety. A lot of anxiety caused by exams, pressures, that a counsellor would have been great to still have within our school.
Okay, thank you, Claire.
It's just 2 points that Janet had made, is that kids nowadays aren't just taking all their information in from schools, and we would think that things like PSE isn't just getting taught by teachers, it should be getting taught by parents. There should be somewhere that the kids can go online, like a Facebook page or like even information on Google. It is really hard. I've just recently been doing some research into sex education and its impacts on sexual health. And I was trying to find out where people are getting their information from. And there's nothing, there's no proper informed information online for kids to get it. And I think if you asked a lot of the children where they got most of their education about sex education, they would say online. or like pornography or things like that. And that's where kids are having to go now because of that. And another thing is you mentioned life skills. I think life skills is something that's completely missing from the curriculum. I left school 3 years ago and I still don't think I even know how to put a washing machine on. Phone my mum every time. But things like a bank account, people getting it, I know people that have got into massive amounts of like student loans debt because they just keep on extending their overdraft because they don't know how to manage finances. And that's something that we're going to have kids who have had the like fortunate enough to go to university but are going to end up in a lot of debt because they've not managed to work out their finances. They're maybe not going to be able to afford a house because they've got themselves. And I think I still don't know what a credit score is, and I'm a fourth-year medical student. Like, these things should be taught at an early level so that people don't feel like they're just kind of left and abandoned when they've left university and they've got nowhere to go.
Joanna?
What Joanne spoke about was the very definition of a whole schools approach, and that's often what's advocated, but I don't know necessarily we know what we mean, but it's exactly that. I mean, it's all very well and good what's delivered in the class, but how do we respond to incidents outside the class? Do we have zero tolerance in language and that? And that these are expectations that everybody in the school environment should expect, not just pupils, but teachers and support staff and everybody else. And I do think in responding to incidents, I wonder if teachers are confident in terms of child protection boundaries, particularly in the kind of online space where there's been sharing of images. I think there's maybe an area to explore in terms of teachers' confidence and how much to contain and how much becomes child protection. In terms of the mandating of PSE, we're definitely in favour of it. And I think there's a difference between making it prescriptive but making it mandatory, because mandatory gives it parity of esteem with all the other subjects that we're talking about, and it currently doesn't have that. And just a wee bit in the online space, because that's where we're really interested and really worried, is because we know that the online space is increasingly where children and young people, and actually me, are spending loads of our time. And we are really concerned that children are getting their sex education from pornography. We did some research and it was like by the age of 14, 90-odd% had seen pornography. And about half of boys felt that was an accurate representation of sex. And girls were articulating that they were very worried that boys' impressions of women and attitudes towards women were negatively impacted by exposure to pornography. So there's real areas we need to look at and make sure that we're equipped in building children's resilience. I mean, I wouldn't advocate removing phones or being paternalistic and don't ever send or whatever. It has to be that open and discursive, and equipping children and young people with the knowledge and the skills and the resilience to navigate that. So, you know, what is a coercive relationship? What is pornography? What does it actually mean? What are healthy relationships? There's things that PSE gives a good opportunity to explore.
Okay, there's a couple of people, well, there's a number of people still want to come in, but one of the things I'd like to try and get to is we've kind of talked a lot about what the issues are. How do we resolve them? You know what I mean? How do you make PSE work better than you think it is just now? But we've got Jack, do you want to go next?
Yep, just to respond to Joanne's question earlier about who should really create the content of the curriculum or PSE lessons across Scotland is, yes, it should be done by teachers, but it should also be done in partnership with young people who are currently either in school or have just currently left school, and more specifically, groups such as women, such as LGBT plus people. But we haven't talked about race, we haven't talked about disabilities today, which is also really important when we're talking about relationship education or inclusive education in general. So, you know, these are factors and these are communities of people that we all need to be concerned about going forward when we're actually talking about this. So to find solutions, like, it needs to be done. This curriculum or the content of PSE in the future needs to be a partnership approach between communities as well as teachers.
Thank you for that. Erin, then Jordan, then Hilary.
I would echo that it does need to be a partnership approach, and again, obviously, highlighting the point that if young people are expressing that they just see PSE as a waste of time, then they're not engaged in it. If young people are actually having involvement and get to see what is kind of being taught, then they're going to turn up, they're going to want to be there. And I think the point that was raised about the social media element links very highly into mental health, in terms of, especially for young women who maybe assume that is what women are supposed to look like or behave, or and I think that is really, really worrying. That's something that has also came through the Youth Parliament, that social media is where a lot of people are also being bullied, as well as it's an information source where people go to get information because they feel they're not getting it in school. It's also a big point in our campaign that schools should be talking about the impacts of mental health on social media. A lot of the bullying is from social media, and that is something that is quite difficult for teachers to deal with in school, because a lot of these issues are coming into school. Like, the bullying in school is mostly from social media now. So it's like raising awareness of the impacts of bullying on someone's mental health, rather than just the "this is bullying is bad, don't do it." It's not a very good solution, and that is why we are so pushing for mental health awareness and bringing in that modern day rise of mental health and how that can actually really, really impact a young person's performance at school or their mental health.
Thank you. Jordan?
Yeah, just briefly on Joanne's point about where do we find the balance between identifying what is simply maybe societal prejudice and what is actually out-and-out prejudice. I think that it's about ensuring that schools are enforcing the Equality Act. Workplaces are generally good on the Equality Act. My workplace, for example, has very clear policies in terms of what should be said, what shouldn't be said, what's illegal to say, what's a hate crime, whereas a lot of the schools that we're going into, yeah, they'll say that their rights respect in schools, but the kids themselves do not even know that homophobic language or homophobic speech is classified as a hate crime. We have to tell them that during assemblies. So it is about, I think there's definitely an argument, which is perhaps separate to the PSE discussion, about strengthening the actual enforcement of the Equality Act in schools in a similar way that we do with other publicly funded sectors. But on your point, James, about how we move forward, our model is effectively that no one thing will work to tackle this. So simply just having good guidance, which is statutory, or simply having mandatory PSE is not going to work on its own. Simply having teacher training won't work on its own. It needs to come in for a multi-pronged level. So what we're kind of advocating for is what we're exploring right now in terms of how do we deal with LGBT issues in school is what can we do, perhaps from a legislative level, first of all, what can we do to set a standard for schools? What statutory duties can we put on local authorities? You've got the Health and Nutrition Act of 2007, which says that all schools must be health-promoting schools. Is that the argument we are making is that when it comes to equalities and human rights, can we perhaps go down that same avenue and that there should be statutory duties to say that all schools should be LGBTI inclusive, or all schools should be focusing on the issues facing young people? So first of all, you need your kind of national and your systemic foundation, which we would argue would be achieved through a legislative level and enacted a bill. But then you need a good, cost-free and effective system of teacher training. What we're exploring with the other LGBT organisations is there a single national programme that we can come up with and that all of the organisations can run from, so that we're not going into a school teaching training teachers on one thing and Stonewall are doing another and LGBT youth are doing another. So we among ourselves are trying to find some form of consistency that could be delivered free of charge that we can actually go into schools and do. But what are we actually training teachers on? We need inclusive guidance there. First of all, we need to be able to have guidance and policies and frameworks which are not just given to teachers and says, here you go, read this 300-page booklet and deliver it in a school, but it's a case of, here is this guidance and we're going to train you on how to do that within school. And then again, recording a bullying, which is not necessarily relevant to PSE, but a very important thing is about monitoring. The Education Scotland Schools Inspections process currently does have an equalities indicator, but what that effectively means, and we've spoke to some head teachers at some schools in Glasgow who have actually seen this happen, is that because it's just a generic equalities approach, if a school is really, really, really good and very clear that racism is zero tolerance and really good on, let's say, inclusivity for pupils with a disability or additional supports, then they will pass that equalities inspection, but there could be nothing on LGBT. So what we're asking for is for an LGBT-specific indicator in the schools inspections process. So effectively, the three most important things are inclusion, training and monitoring, your inclusive guidance, your teacher training and your effective monitoring of how that is being delivered within schools. We are obviously happy to leave our strategy papers with you, but I think that it's important to understand that when it comes to something like this, it's not a single, there's obviously a lot that has to change.
Okay, thanks very much for that, Jordan. Hilary.
Thank you.
Just to again provide the views of young people directly in relation to the points that Joanne has made, with again within the Creating a Healthier Scotland report, one of the key recommendations, the three key recommendations from young people themselves, was to introduce a zero tolerance system where young people are equipped with the knowledge they need to understand mental health, well-being, and the negative effects that stigma can have. And that's both teachers and students within schools. One of the other worthwhile things to mention that the young people raised was to stop removing young carers, young parents, or children dealing with crisis at home from classes. And I think that's something quite relevant, something we haven't discussed at all, but the importance of ensuring these groups are part of normal school hours, and that includes PSE. In terms of going forward, I would just reiterate Young Scots' view of the importance of ensuring that young people have the opportunity to influence the design and delivery of PSE. And again, I'd reiterate the information that we do provide as an organisation and the importance for us to engage more with schools directly to deliver that.
Okay, thank you. I'd like to bring in Clare Adamson, then Daniel Johnson, and you know, we can get responses to both points.
Thank you very much. There's so many areas that's been covered today. It's difficult to try and sort of like bring it all together. But in terms of, I think it was Ross that had said, what's the consequences of not doing this? I think to reverse that is if we would know we were getting this right if we were measuring the outcomes. And I think that's really, really important. My son's left school, but when he was in about third year, came home with a letter about a very serious STD outbreak in the area, which the health service were doing an intervention on with the schools because it was so serious. But at that time, he'd had no sex education at all from the school itself, you know, and that seemed the kind of complete dichotomy that we have here about you know, the consequences for individual and societal consequences and cost to the health service and all these things that can happen. But I really think that the outcomes part of it is really important, you know, looking at financial outcomes for young people, the health outcomes, mental health outcomes for young people, if we're getting this right, should be seen to be improved. And I think monitoring that in some ways is really important.
Thanks very much, Claire. Daniel?
Yeah. Just a few comments. First of all, very specifically, Erin, it's great having a student teacher with us around the table, and you hinted that there's been thought in terms of the teacher training. I'd just be interested to know actually kind of what, in terms of the content of your course, what is actually there and kind of your thoughts on what could be improved. And more generally, and there's lots more I could talk about, but I was also very struck by what something Joanna said about it has to start much earlier than secondary school. I think probably even needs to start before school. And certainly I'm conscious with my own wee ones who are preschool, you know, talking about equal marriage, for example, is really important. Something I've been, so I'm just sort of interested in, you know, I think that in order for this to be effective, it needs to be reach out beyond school. And certainly we've talked about agencies, but it actually needs to draw in and be supported by parents. And just kind of how we do that, I think, is not easy, but I think it's really important. And if I'd be very interested in reflections on that.
Erin.
Yeah, so just back to Daniel's point. I think obviously as well, maybe the generation that I am is becoming a wee bit more confident within themselves. I know in my class, like the people who are in our class are quite confident in who they are or talking about mental health. But when you talk about what we've learned, we've went through like case studies, and our tutors are quite good at actually obviously bringing us up to speed of modern day Scotland, and that young people have a whole range of different issues. And I think that's really, really important. But I think it is because there is good steps being took that is our generation is actually recognising that when we want to go into the teacher profession, we want to change it. And I think as well that's drawn on our own experiences of having previous maybe prejudice in our school. But I think that links back to Joanne's point on terms of what if you are gay, you feel like it's important that young people have role models, but I don't think sometimes maybe teachers can actually still feel confident that they could actually be confident they're a gay teacher, or they're a teacher that's had a mental health problem, that they actually might feel that they don't have a place to go if they're going to face bullying from their work environment or indeed the pupils. And I think something that we need to also emphasise is the support for teachers as well. If we're speaking about PSE, it's great to put all these things in the curriculum, but teachers do hear a lot of quite deep stuff from young people, and I don't think that sometimes they feel, what do I do with this?
Is that not then where the adequate training should be in place for them to,
yeah,
you know, so that when they get in there,
but I do think that definitely the now going through the student teaching programme, I think it is really, really good. The programme that I'm on, it's a lot of inclusion. Even the policy that we're looking at is really, really inclusive. And when I went on a voluntary placement, I could see the difference from the training that I'm getting to the training that teachers who've been in it for years are getting.
Can I ask just on that one then, do you see a difference between the older generation of teachers,
yep,
and the younger generation of teachers in the way that they're capable of dealing with these sort of issues? Clare?
Yeah, we were speaking to a primary seven teacher who he himself identified as he was gay, and his class were completely fine with it. But then we went into another school where they asked us to do an LGBT lesson because the kids didn't understand it and he felt he was getting bullied himself. So I think it depends on your school, how much background training the teachers have had handling this, and how much background information the kids already know. And I think it is really important, like Daniel said, that it's before school that we need to iron out these issues and make sure that they know that everyone is included, whether depending on your sexuality, your gender, your race, if you're disabled or anything, then everyone should be included. But that's before school, that's kind of parent-led thing.
Yeah, okay. Joanna.
24-year-olds, and it's fantastic to be able to say to them that they can marry a man or a woman. It's fantastic, and they have never known anything else, and that is fantastic. We've done a guide in terms of preventing sexual abuse, which is called the underwear rule, and we've trained nurseries in this, and it's basically preventing sexual abuse, but you don't need to mention the word sex, and it's just saying, you know, what's under your pants is private, it belongs to you, no means no, and who are safe adults to speak to if you're worried about something. So it's really, really age appropriate. But I think there are mechanisms. That's just one example that we've done. But I think what's interesting, your previous discussion about the secondary legislation about the extension of early years in childcare, it's actually not an area we've looked at, but how what's the PSE content of nursery curriculum? I mean, I don't know that, but that's something as children, more and more children are at nursery for longer, what kind of messages are we given in terms of this kind of sphere? It'd be interesting to look at.
Jordan.
Yeah, I agree with Daniel that it has to start before school. However, the reality is that there are still a lot of parents in this country who will not discuss any of these issues with their kids. My mum certainly wouldn't have sat down and been in-depth talking about sex with me. And sadly, unfortunately, there are still parents who will be passing on their own prejudices to their children. So I think the position that we have is that the reality is that there are kids who won't get any of this kind of education at home, so it is the responsibility of schools, of all of us, to make sure that they get that somewhere. On the point about primary schools, so what we've actually found with primary schools, obviously we do primary teacher training, and it's actually delivered by a primary teacher who specialises in LGBT, so it is quite good. But we've actually found that when it comes to primary schools, it's often really the simple little things which can be done. It's less complex than it is at a secondary level, especially when right now in schools we've already got a lot of prejudice breeding in secondary schools. So there's little things that we do, like we'll fund LGBT inclusive and LGBT friendly books into primary schools, and Scott Mowat, who does our teacher training, he talks quite a lot about how to actually break down the whole concepts of equality and prejudice for primary school children. So it's effectively the same principles, but it's about putting it in age appropriate language, and books are a really, really good way to do that. But again, the fact that we are having to fund it when we rely on trade union donations, I think says quite a lot about where funding is going into schools. And also, just in case I don't get to come back in, I just want to point out that we actually have John Naples Campbell, who delivers our secondary teacher training. He has developed and delivers LGBT inclusive PSE lessons for S1 AS4, so we've got PSE lessons there if you want me to send them over to the clerks to look at.
Yeah, that'd be very helpful, and I'm really impressed that Jordan thinks I'm strong enough to keep him out of the conversation for the session.
I just don't know how much time we have left.
Ross Thompson.
Thank you very much, convener. Just given the discussion, we've had a couple of reflections. Going back to Jack's point about bullying and the figures obtained by TIE and that high percentage of pupils across Scotland who experience, you know, homophobic bullying in their school, and actually what Clare was saying about the casual use of language as well, I just kind of want to delve into that a bit deeper. I mean, just as an example, I mean, I came out when I was in university. I didn't do it when I was at school, and I suppose it was a more inclusive environment or felt like it. And I know that during my primary school years and my secondary school years, I got bullied horrendously. And it was homophobic language and homophobic bullying. And there was others who got exactly the same, and they weren't even gay, but they got it. And so that kind of bullying does cut across different young people. It's not just people who are gay that experience it, and it's staff as well. Even though they're not, they still get that kind of level of abuse. So it's looking at how do we measure that and quantify that. Obviously, TIE have done fantastic work in gathering that data. But I know speaking to teachers in schools in my own area, Aberdeen, I know that although they have forms to complete, it's not an actual requirement to note down what a homophobic bullying incident is. And when I kind of pressed them a bit more on that, they said, well, they would struggle sometimes to identify it, which I found quite hard, but they said they would struggle to identify it because is it something that's being said in the playground? Is it lads who are having fun as lads? You know, they thought it was really difficult to judge and how do you quantify it. So in terms of drilling down the point of how we record those incidents, I'd be really interested in what people thought we could do. So the government has better data on that, so things are evidence-led. And I suppose my other question is, listen to the discussion, and I mean, it sounds like a simple question. What a good PSE looks like, what a PSE class should look like, because the discussions we had at Dalkeith, speaking to the young people there, a whole range of issues came up around about, you know, sexual health, LGBT equality, but also around about, as has been mentioned, the financial side of things, how what you do when you get a credit card, a debit account, but also citizenship came up, understanding elections and democracy. They felt in that particular school that they hadn't covered that enough, given that 16, 17-year-olds have the right to go out and vote, that not a lot of them are aware they could go and register to vote. So in terms of what is within a PSE class and the time that's dedicated to each thing, is to get a better understanding for me what a good PSE class should look like, how that should be run, and how that comes about. Might be really simple.
Does anybody want to go, Jack?
What a good PSE class would look like, it would be something that completely breaks down and totally explains the differences between, first of all, sex and gender, first of all, and realising actually the binary of sex and the binary of gender doesn't exist, it's a spectrum. So first and foremost, like making sure that people, not just teachers, not just pupils, but actually just general society knows that as well. And to relate that back to Daniel's previous question about what can we do before school to try and influence that, we are terribly bad as a society from the very get-go that someone gets pregnant, asking if it's a boy or a girl before they've even got to the age of being able to determine that for themselves. We're already assigning colours. When they're a toddler, we're already saying, we're already assuming that if they have a friend of the opposite gender, then, you know, we assume that it's a boyfriend or a girlfriend, and we like to try and influence that behaviour. And what that does is it definitely influences the bullying that we see later in life at primary and secondary school, because we have that idea about of what normal is to be cisgendered, or is it to be heteronormative as well. So we've got to change, you know, we've got to think about how do we challenge those values, how do we challenge those norms. And I think looking at that and you know, doing that inside, you know, PSE lessons and out with PSE lessons, that is the way that we'll definitely try and change that, and definitely try and way that we will clamp down on you know, the huge amount of bullying that we still see in secondary schools. As I said at the start, it's been 17 years since Section 28, but it's still here in a way, it's still in our schools. So we need to be looking at how do we use PSE to truly make sure that Section 28 is dead.
Okay. Anybody else want to make a comment? No. Clare.
I would just say from like PSE, like what I would think from PSE is you want people's, like give them the information, but I think school for me was not just giving people the information but giving them the tools to find out some information themselves. So giving them like signposts to using organisations like Young Scot or even like Durex have brought out a new, that's our sponsor, so that's the only reason I know this. It's like the guidance for teachers. No, it's not. But it's like they've got this thing that's for teachers and like it would give teachers a place to go where they can find out information and it's kept up to date with the British Institute of Sexual Health, but it keeps them up. So like kids are needing to find out information themselves and need a place to go. And I think that's a really important thing that needs to be brought about, is giving them a place to go if they can't get this information in school and they can't get it from their parents, where can they get it?
Janet?
Lesson looks like everybody in an inclusive environment, happy, achieving, safe and learning. I think if the teachers are given the right tools and the right information and then they're able to facilitate a discussion. I think it's a lot of the information that I read, it was, oh, it's a PowerPoint, oh, it's a, you know, a chat, but it's giving them the tools in order to facilitate discussion, because we've got to remember that in Scotland we've got amazing young people who are going to be successful learners and confident individuals, and it's about making sure that we're bringing those principles into the classroom and making them confident and being able to come here and say, yes, I had a great PSE experience when I was in school and I wish that you were sitting here saying that. And then again, signposting just a couple of links, but to local organisations, you know. For example, in our area, we signpost to the Sandyford, and then national organisations like yourself. And as long as we've got that information, then we'll cascade it out. But discussion's key.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm going to move on to Colin first, and then you know, we can comment on both.
Thank you, Mayor. I'd like to go back actually to a comment you made at the very start of this. I've been reading through all these submissions and I've jotted down in the back of an envelope here more than 30 subjects which people think should be included in PSE, all of which, when you look in isolation, have merit. Now, Hilary mentioned the possibility that some of these subjects might be more appropriately determined at local level, depending on what the local priority was. But how do we go about determining what the core priorities are? How do we determine what should be there for everybody and leaving flexibility still at a local level to add other pieces in? I wonder if they had a view on that.
Jordan, you were wanted back in, so maybe you went.
Well, it's interesting because this is something that I think, to be honest, that a lot of people maybe misunderstand about our campaign. A lot of people assume that what we're trying to do is tell every single school that this is how you must teach LGBT issues, and it's not. What we're trying to do is lift schools up to a particular standard and ensure that there is a requirement on schools to engage with inclusive education in order to tackle prejudice-based bullying. How the schools do that is up to them. We would argue that there does need to be some core principles laid out. So, for example, I think that, to be honest, how you would go about that and how we went about it was by data, research, discussion, visiting schools. We spent the first year of our campaign speaking to teachers, speaking to young people, and it wasn't long until we realised that there were a lot of things that were consistently coming up. And what we'd done was we sat down with that information, we sat with young people, we sat with teachers, and we said, what would you want to see through a teacher training course? What would you want to see discussed in your school? And all the same things were coming back to us when it came to LGBT. So as Jack's already mentioned, the gender spectrum, sexual fluidity, identity, where they can get support, LGBT history is another big thing. So there are things that young people want to be taught. How you would do that in terms of looking at PSE nationally, I would again say that I think that what you guys have been doing with the public submissions is definitely put you at a good head start. there are things within those submissions which are clearly dominating. So LGBT, mental health, there was a lot about finance and tax. Start with the things that have dominated and look at, but also as well, look at legislation, look at the Equality Act, look at the data that we have that tells us that LGBT young people face disproportionately higher rates of bullying, and then think, we have all these issues, what can we do to ensure that there is a core curricular aspect of PSE? So the way that we approach it is that we would suggest that there are certain things which every single school should be looking at when it comes to LGBT issues. There are certain fundamental things which are too important to young people's identity and well-being to be discarded, such as that it is all right to be LGBT, and that if you are LGBT, here is where you can access support. Let's have a class discussion about this. Homophobia is wrong, that yes, using language such as you're so gay is actually homophobic and it's not okay. So there are certain fundamental things which need to be looked at, but then we are also quite big on that within the curriculum for excellence, there should be room for teachers to pick up on issues and develop it based on what they think that their pupils need to hear. So one of the things that we actually have is this document, which again I'll leave, it's called Moments. And what we effectively kind of believe in is what we would call curriculum mapping. It's about using the curriculum for excellence, taking the expectations and outcomes, taking the indicators and the benchmarks and thinking, okay, so I'm just, for example, this is effectively just an LGBT history timeline, but what we've done is we've linked key moments from LGBT history into curricular core subjects within the curriculum. So for example, 1945, liberation of Nazi concentration camps, those interned for homosexuality are not freed, that's relevant to social studies and religious moral education. So if I'm a social studies teacher, I can look at this document and think, here is a kind of starting point as to where I can discuss this. I'm talking about the Holocaust, so let's maybe look at the pink triangle. So it's about guiding teachers in the right direction. That's what we would effectively call, when it comes to LGBT history, your core part of your curriculum. What you do with all these little moments is completely up to you. How you develop upon them is completely up to you, but it is about having a core aspect there, and then trusting that teachers, by having the right training, will be able to be flexible enough to actually develop upon that. So I hope that answered the question.
Yes, thank you very much. And you got an advert in for your magazine as well. Erin?
I would also really 100% agree with Jordan, what you just said there. But in terms of, I think it was Colin, what you said, how it is structured and things like that. I think one of the big core things for the Scottish Youth Parliament is that there is Scottish Youth, like members of the Scottish Youth Parliament in every local authority, and we have sittings three times a year. So we have a strong mandate and a strong platform of to get young people's voices, and I think that has to be used. You know, it's a really, really useful tool and a platform that is bringing, we're all bringing all our local issues. So as MSYPs, we're all bringing our local issues to a national platform. And that's why I think it's really good that we're having this conversation today, because it's so clear nationally that there is a lot of reform that is needed in PSE. So I think nationally, it should be the priorities. So things from the submission or using organisations like Young Scots High Campaign, Scottish Youth Parliament, and prioritising national ones, but then obviously allowing local to dip into the local issues. But I think the main point for the Scottish Youth Parliament today is that the biggest tool is young people. They have to be engaged in order to create. It's great to see we want an inclusive and engaging whatever on paper, but if that's not actually being put into action, then it's pretty clear from the Scottish Youth Parliament that the young people are not being engaged. Young people have to be included in the making of their sessions, or it's not going to be effective, whether that looks great on paper or not. So the core element for us is that young people's voices have to be included in the making of their own sessions and what they're learning about.
Thank you very much. Hello.
So Young Scot provide information nationally and locally just in response to that, and that is engaging with local organisations and community learning and development, which Tavish actually mentioned earlier on in relation to youth workers.
To provide, again, linking to what Erin's saying, the views of young people around a typical PSE class, young people have stated themselves that PSHE should be a more discursive class where experiences and opinions of young people are shared rather than defined and influenced solely by the teacher. And I think that's quite an interesting kind of perspective on that one from young people's views.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to bring in Ross. Ross, I've got a couple of points I'd like to make. And that might open another level of discussion.
Yeah, just briefly, the nature of the conversation, a few of these have been raised already, but the issue of when to start these particular topics has came up time and time again. I think particularly with issues around sex and relationships and gender, people are almost afraid to start that conversation. Too many people are afraid to advocate that young children should be learning about sex and relationships, which seems like a nonsense. I mean, Jordan's mentioned feelings in S1, being aware of your sexuality and the issues that can cause. We are very aware of the number of 5, 6, 7-year-olds who are presenting as trans these days. And that issue is not coming up enough. I'd just like to put that out there. Beyond this idea that we need to start this younger, specifically when should we start educating young people and children about these issues? At what age should children be learning that gender is a spectrum, as has been said, that gender and sex are different? Because it's very easy to do that. I mean, Jack's mentioned it already. I've run a workshop with teenagers using the genderbread person. You can use a genderbread person with a 5-year-old just as easily as you can use it with a 12-year-old. So it is possible. So I'd like to put that question out. Specifically, when do we start on these areas? And the other area I'd like to raise, and Ross brought it up a bit already, is this kind of civic education, rights-based education. Tens of thousands of 16, 17-year-olds will vote this year, but for many of them, the only way that they'll know what their local council actually does is if they chose modern studies or politics as a subject at school. And in many schools, that's not even an option. So there has to be a recognition that, especially now, I mean, the Youth Parliament's been running a campaign for political education for years, but now that we've got votes at 16, this really should seem as essential. And the issue of rights transitions into a whole range of other areas. Workers' rights, for example. Most young people will leave school not knowing what the minimum wage is. They won't know what exploitation is, and probably many will be exploited at work because of that. They won't know what a trade union can do for them. I only learned about trade unions in modern studies, and what I essentially learned was they got beat in the 80s. That's really not the case. Interesting to hear people's thoughts around that, because in some schools they do it really well. The STUC does brilliant workshops on how unions can help people, they can defend young workers' rights. But I'd be interested in people's thoughts on that as well.
Okay, who wants to start tonight? Clare,
this is just drawn more from my personal experience than from Sex Expression UK, but at school we didn't get any kind of politics kind of education as such. And I took modern studies up to standard grade level. No, they don't even exist anymore. But I actually find that recently more people at young ages have been involved. I know from 3 of my friends are part of political parties and advocate it, and it's actually getting one person involved in it kind of trickles down in the school, because then you want to find out. And I was like, oh, what does she do there? And that's how I found out. But at the age of 21, I think I've taken part in 6 elections, and I didn't have a clue. I stand outside like polling stations, and I'm like, I don't know who I'm going to vote for, because I don't want to do what probably like other generations have done. You just vote what your parents have voted. But I don't actually know I didn't know what each party stood for or anything before that. So actually I had to go online, I had to look for it myself. Whereas even taking things at modern studies, you don't actually find these things out. So it's, again, I think social media should be used at this point to be like, oh, well, this is what you're going to do. This is what impacts are going to be. This is what you're actually voting for. Because I think my first election was a European election, and I didn't really know what I was voting for. But I was like, oh, I'm now legally allowed to vote. I'm going to vote. But if you had it written down somewhere that people could go and find out, and like, or even like a Facebook page where you could see what you were going to vote for and what its impacts were going to be, it would involve a lot more young people. And I'd say most young people do have social media or do have access to the internet and can find things out. So if it's written there in simple forms, this is what you're voting for, these are what like policies are, but in terms that maybe 16, 17-year-olds will understand and be relevant to 16, 17-year-olds, right, that they're going to be more encouraged to vote, and they're going to be more encouraged to get involved in things like politics and know what they're doing. and be able to take part in, like, know what trade unions are. I worked in the NHS for 3 years now, and I've only just joined my union, but I didn't know what it was until somebody sat down and spoke to me. And I would say I went to school and did my 6 years at school, but never got anything about that in the past.
Okay, thank you, Jordan.
Yeah, so I'll take Ross's 2 points. The first one, our argument is that it should be nursery level, to be honest, and it's all about, as has already been mentioned, making sure that it's age-appropriate. So you wouldn't run into a nursery and obviously start talking about sex, but you would go into a nursery and maybe point out, especially also when, obviously, thankfully, we've progressed on same-sex adoption. There's going to be lots more same-sex parents turning up to the gates of a nursery. And so it's about making sure that the other kids in the school are aware that actually there are different family types. And again, I'll come back to you. I think one of the simplest ways to be doing that is through books. Nursery, there are lots of nursery and also early level primary LGBT friendly books available. So that's, I would argue, nursery. The second point about political education, and I'll just be really brief on this. My modern studies was my favourite subject at school, and I went on to do, well, still am at uni doing sociology, but my modern studies class, we didn't really look a lot, to be honest, at Scotland. We looked more at America, China. We focused quite a lot on British politics. But what I would actually argue, and I've said this quite a lot, is that maybe what modern studies should start doing is a little bit of political theory and then also contemporary national politics. So political theory, it took me until university to figure out what capitalism, socialism, communism, anarchism, what all of these political concepts were. We probably should be talking about that with kids because it will help them understand the political, how politics, not even just in Scotland, but how politics is framed a little bit more between left, centre and right. And also we should be talking to them about how the Scottish Parliament works, about how Scottish Government works, about the systems, about voting systems, because my parents don't even understand the voting system, and a lot of kids don't. So,
okay, thank you. Joanne, what's coming in then?
Just to say to Ross, as an AIS member in the 80s, we were actually quite successful in achieving things for the teaching profession. And it wasn't all about strikes, and a lot of the things we now regard as the norm within the workplace is because the trade unions were actually effective. But anyway, that's a personal thing. I think
everybody's advertising today, aren't they?
I suppose there's a couple of things. I think there's a danger of everything that we think we want to change in society becomes the responsibility of the schools. At one level, trade unions have to be advocates for themselves. Women have to be advocates for themselves. We have to, you know, but that's not to say that there is not a role for society in supporting women and challenging attitudes and all the rest of it. And as a mother of now adult children, I can remember as I was never a young mother, but when they were young, having this battle about what toys they should be playing with and what colours were accepted and all that. So I recognise and think that these are really, really important questions. But it's where it's the matter for the school and where are there other places this can be done. And I suppose the question I'm quite interested in is round, you talked about young people leading and directing what the curriculum would be around PSE. If I were being the devil's advocate and from my own experience, what do you do in a class where the conversation is driven by those who are hostile to things that we believe as equality? Because I had that dilemma as a school teacher, which is a balance between opening up the debate and then suddenly realising the people who were in charge of the debate were making worse the question because they had been given permission to say things that in normal circumstances wouldn't be allowed to say in my class. So I wonder whether in your groups and organisations, as you know, campaign groups like NUS and so on, where does the balance between creating a space where young people can explore these ideas and not, but then with the school's permission to step in or the organisation's position to step in and say, no, you've gone too far? Because I think that's you're able to say something about this, but I think that's the biggest challenge for the profession. It's not to say that most young people are engaging with it, will not do it in an active way. But if there's homophobic bullying, for example, in a school, if it's young people who are doing it, how do you create a space where you have that conversation without simply amplifying that and that perhaps be taken out of the classroom and beyond?
Right. Start with you, Janet, and then Jack.
think it's really important to establish boundaries within the PSE class from the minute in S1 that they step in the door. And the values that you put across within your class, but also your school, are very clear, because I think there is a very fine line being a PSE teacher, same as there would be in a drama classroom, for example. Whenever you're exploring different social situations or different topics, there is going to be different views based on children's home life, on different children's experiences. So it's about having a positive impact on that discussion, but setting those boundaries from the start. And what I've noticed from a lot of the organisations that have come into school, they do set the class contract at the start that we are going to be respectful and we are going to be responsible individuals here as we start this discussion. And I think that is a really clear place to start. So as long as that's established, in my experience, that's had a positive impact. To go to your question about the trade unions and the teaching about voting in schools, I've had the delight of running a masterclass just there for S2 and S3 on trade unions through the Modern Studies department. And that's been a really interesting experience for me, team teaching with a Modern Studies teacher in the school. And I would say that the information given through the trade unions as a whole pack on kind of workers' rights and things, that's been really informative. But I think we run specific masterclasses for pupils in S2 and S3 that they can opt into that they might not have chosen Modern Studies. So to kind of create depth to our curriculum, that's been a really positive thing. I would feel, as a PSE teacher, I'm not quite sure what kind of year group that would come into, but I think it's relevant as well. We'll look forward to having you back to teach a little lesson, I think, Ross.
Also just a few years too early together.
I think we'll look forward to welcoming you back to speak about your experience in the Scottish Parliament, but also to teach now about the voting system. So
I think we'll be keeping an eye on that one. Jack?
I'm going to try and respond to three questions, but do that really quickly.
I mean to interrupt, but we are getting close to the end of the session, so if everybody could they make their answers as short as possible?
That's fine. So just to start with Joanne's point, really about how do we make sure that this is an inclusive space? It really has to be a safe space, not just in terms of being safe to be there, but in terms of being safe to ask, you know, difficult and maybe tricky questions as well. But being done in a respectful manner is really, really important. And there seems to be a bit of debate around right now about safe spaces versus being seen as special snowflakes. But if you don't have a safe space, you have a 90% percentage of LGBT people being bullied in schools. So it's incredibly important, because as soon as you don't have a safe space, that's a barrier to education. And if the Scottish Parliament, the Scottish Government, wants to make sure that there is less, as many barriers as possible for an education system that is truly fair, that making sure that that is a safe space is incredibly important. And then to go on to Ross's point about, you know, how early do we need to start talking about the spectrum of gender? I would agree with Jordan's point that, you know, nursery has to be, you know, a central place for that. But I would actually also say that there's something that needs to be talked about in the healthcare system as well, in terms of the NHS being aware and being quite assertive of the differences between sex and gender is really, really important, because I think that is a core part of where we start to see problems of being your assigned gender at birth, rather than stating what sex it is, can lead to very confusing and very oppressive situations as a trans person myself later down in life. And then to quickly go into Colin's point about, you know, we've talked about lots and lots of issues today, but what do we prioritise? And I got a little bit jealous of Jordan earlier, because it's LGBT History Month and we are, you know, and you got to quote some LGBT History Month. So I would like to quote some as well, actually. So Marsha P. Johnston, disabled trans women of colour, kick-started the modern LGBT plus movement. And one of my favourite quotes from her was, there is no pride in some of us without liberation for us all. And we need to be looking at all these issues, not just some. We can't just think that some of these issues prioritise over others. So someone who identifies as trans, disabled, as queer, as also a woman, you know, none of my identities are more important than others. So we need to be talking about, you know, we need to be inclusive with education, but we also need to be talking about it in an intersectional way where identities overlap and crisscross. So if we want to be truly inclusive with PSE lessons, then we need to teach it in an intersectional manner where all identities are considered just as great as each other.
Okay, thank you very much. Erin?
So going back to Ross's point, I think you probably answered your own question in terms of, I think the earliest is better. Daniel did make a good point earlier, but again, not everybody gets that sort of attitude in their home life, and the prejudices do pass on. So I think if we can develop it in nursery with the books and things like that, what Jordan was talking about, not just in inclusive education, but also in mental health and things like that as well, then that is a really, really, really good starting point. But going back to Joanne's point, I think it's really important. And I think as a personal student teacher as well, like looking at the profession and then seeing a teaching recruitment problem, for me, I'm like, well, sometimes I get like overwhelmed by how much teachers are expected to do. And I think that is what I'm finding in my class. A lot of people are maybe wanting to be teachers, but maybe teachers are expected to be everything now. And I think that is a problem as well in terms of actually recruiting teachers into teaching, because they're expected to be psychologists and teachers and doctors and everything. And I think that is pretty overwhelming. I find that really overwhelming and quite scary to go into the profession because of that. But I think as well, when you talk about what you're talking about, Joanne, how do you strike the balance between the discussion? I think it's the ethos of the school, that back to your first point that you made earlier, that the head teacher of that school has to be set that standard, that consistent standard, all the time. And I think there has to be an ethos that children do know in their school, and that it does have to be a safe environment. But I do also understand the fact that if it is young people led, then there can be a lot of like problems that arise. But I think it is trying to just like early intervention and education to prevent those prejudices arising, and also that there is a clear ethos of what can be said and what cannot. Because sometimes people say things and they don't know that they're being prejudiced, or they don't know that they are offending someone. So if there is a clear guide before, if it's a young person-led session of what they can and what they can't do, I think that would be really helpful.
Thank you, Helen.
Yeah, in response directly to Joanne, boundaries, as has been noted, are essential when it comes to this. And when we speak about co-design, the co-element is probably most important. So it's young people and professionals, whether they're teachers or others, working at an equal level, so working together. So there's a real kind of boundary facilitation role for teachers within that. The young people themselves, actually immediately after the point that I'd made that Joanne was responding to, also suggested that other young people should be invited into that stigma-free environment to share their personal experience if they feel comfortable to do so. So suggesting peer mentors around different issues, whether it's eating disorders or whatever, to share that so that young people can learn from them. But obviously that boundary thing is really crucial for that, to ensure it is that stigma-free environment for young people.
Thank you. And Jordan?
Yeah, I think that on Joanne's point, again, it comes back to balance. So what we find, I do agree with Jack's point about ensuring that PSE classes are a safe space. In fact, I think that all schools should effectively be a safe space regardless of what your identity is. But what I do actually think, and I know that this is also a wee bit controversial, but I think that there's a way to talk about safe spaces without sounding patronising. So we, when we go into schools, I guarantee you that if I stood up in front of 400 first years and says, I just want to let you all know that this is a safe space, that I would probably get either laughed at or probably not taken seriously. So the way that you do that is by allowing the kids and pupils to be honest and trusting them and treating them like adults, first of all, without patronising them. So one example of this, as we'll ask the kids, is there anyone in here who doesn't like LGBT people? unfortunately, last week in a school, some of them put their hand up and said, yeah. But then Liam will ask, is there anyone in here who uses homophobic, biphobic or transphobic language and describes some of the language? And initially, you see the kids kind of like looking about, and then Liam will put his hand up and say, well, I'm going to put my hand up because I used it 2 years ago. And then suddenly all the hands in the room go up, and then you get into that conversation. So I think that you can break down that fourth wall per se without actually being kind of patronising of it, and obviously this is not necessarily something that a government can tell teachers how to do. This is how, and this is what we mean about flexibility and trusting teachers. Teachers will know their own class, they will know the kids in their class, they will know most likely what kids can't be trusted to stand up and talk about LGBT issues and what kids can. But I do think that when it comes to PSE, we're talking to kids, school pupils, about very adult issues. They definitely should be treated like adults. They shouldn't be patronised. And they should be included in that format. And again, every good school has a good anti-bullying policy, but I know that that's not something that every school has when it comes to LGBT. So it's about, again, enforcing the Equality Act, enforcing the school's anti-bullying policy, and deciphering what actually is prejudice and what's just social stigma. So, again, it comes down to striking the balance. I would say that the best people to be doing that are teachers based on their understanding of the personalities of their pupils.
OK, thank you very much for that. We're now nearing the end of our discussions. Can I ask if anyone has any points they consider are priorities for the committee that they've not had the chance to make to do so? If not, and if there's something you think of later on, please feel free to email the committee with that point. Erin, you.
I think it is important, going back to the, although there's so many issues, I think it is about actually incorporating a lot of these issues into the full curriculum rather than just restricting it to PSE. And again, obviously, from the Scottish Youth Parliament point of view, we are really, really emphasising mental health in that, because a lot of young people are saying we need more mental health education in PSE, but I actually think we need more mental health education in society as a whole, not just a 30-minute lesson, and to carry that throughout the full curriculum. And I think that not just mental health, but I think, obviously, I'm coming here today to kind of emphasise about mental health education, but I think for any issue that's been discussed today, it's about not just restricting it to PSE, because it is so much wider than that. And I think a lot of these issues can be incorporated in every subject, not just a 40, 50-minute lesson.
Thank you very much for that. Before we move to private session to consider the evidence, I'd really like to thank all our guests today. That was an exceptional panel. We've learned a lot from it. We also have the Cabinet Secretary appearing before the committee in a fortnight, and we'll certainly be raising some of those issues that have come up today with Mr. Swinney. So once again, thank you very much, and we're now moving into private session. Thank you.